Good morning, and welcome to Lafayette Avenue Presbyterian Church here in our 175th year of existence. In fact, it was just last week that we celebrated our official birth date as a church. Look forward to later this year celebrating together as a church family. We're so glad that wherever you are this morning, that you are joining us in spirit and in truth to worship together during this unique time when we are socially distanced and not together physically, that we could be together in spirit. Amen. A few announcements for you this week. We want to remind you of our Tuesday night summer study program beginning at 6:30 p.m. every Tuesday night. It is available on Facebook Live. It is now available on Zoom link. We will provide that link during the week, and it will be on our Facebook page, website, as well as can be emailed to you. You can always request to be on our contact list at mwoodjesus.org. So we hope you'll join us in whatever way you can for our summer study. We are continuing our food tote ministry. We have, as you know, a tote directly outside our sanctuary doors where you can put non-perishable goods for those in most need at this time as we partner with Parkside Lutheran in this community to care for the most vulnerable and the marginalized. So please contribute to this great cause as you can during the week. It is checked daily, so the food will get to the right place. All you have to do is bring it by right here in front of our sanctuary doors in the tote here. So we hope you will find the time to make that happen this week. We now have an official reopen date, a contingent date based on everything our safety and healthy health committee is making plans for reopening our building, preparing our guidelines so that it will be a very safe and sacred experience for you. If you do not feel safe yet to come at that date, or for any reason do not feel that it's best to come, we will be continuing the ministry of Pajama Church. Virtual worship will continue throughout the rest of the year so that we can all worship in the way that's best and most comfortable for our particular needs as a family of faith. We want to think of everyone. So keep that date in mind. It's July the 12th, Sunday. We'll be well into phase four at that time. We will have taken all the precautions necessary, and we are excited to be back together physically here in our church building. And please pray for, of course, our safety and health committee as they make those preparations so that we can all be safe as we are together. And so now, here in our 175th year of ministry, we come together in spirit and in truth to worship the Lord together.
With your grace, give us faithfulness.
Amen. Thank you so much, Teresa and Virginia, for that inspiring beginning to our worship service together, and now our call to worship based out of Psalm 116. What shall I return to the Lord for all his bounty to me? I will lift the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will offer to you a thanksgiving sacrifice and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people, in the courts of the house of the Lord, in your midst, O Jerusalem. Praise the Lord. And now we will be in our Presbyterian blue hymn book on page 543, if you have a copy at home. Or as always, you can join us on our virtual bulletin in the comments section of Facebook Live. Come at this time of confession together, a tradition in the Presbyterian Church where we name our shortcomings before God, knowing we can rely on the grace and mercy and forgiveness we find in Christ our Lord. Will you pray together the prayer of confession with me? God invites us to hold the needs of our sisters and brothers as dear to us as our own needs. We instead stay focused on ourselves and our demands. Forgive us and change us. Change our mind and teach us compassion. Friends, we have good news this morning. We have been claimed and cleansed in Christ. We have been renewed. We have been redeemed by the grace of God. Our sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God. As always at this time in our service, when we are all together, our Christian education director, Heather Jones, leads our children aged 3 to 5th grade to be a part of a special time of training and teaching and singing and craft making as part of our children's ministry here at Lafayette Avenue Presbyterian Church. If you are in that age group and you're watching today, come a little closer to the screen. This is your time in the service. Today, our theme is all about joy. Now, at times like these, or perhaps at times when you're trying to figure out how to get along with your sister or your brother, or even your mom and dad, joy can be hard to find. But one of the greatest ways that we can experience joy is when we find ways to make other people experience joy. That's right. When we share joy, when we see others experiencing joy, it tends to help our mood and our experience of joy a whole bunch. There's something about the contagiousness of joy. So this week, I have a mission for you. If you are one of our children here at Lafayette Avenue Presbyterian Church, or maybe you're watching for the first time and want to join in, we would love for you to join in. I'm going to give you a mission of spreading joy. How can you spread joy this week? In the comments section this afternoon, we're going to put a printable page of a letter that you could write to one of our family here in the Presbyterian Church. It reads, Dear blank, you put the person's name, someone that you want to spread joy to this week. My name is, and I am blank years old. I have been keeping busy during quarantine by, and you put a little bit about what you've been up to. Let's pray for each other. I pray that your day is, and you can fill in the adjective. You can pray for me too. Here's how you can pray for me. You share a little bit about your house, your home, what's going on in your life, and how you would like for this person to pray for you too. And lastly, it says, thank you for being a part of my church family. If you'd like to be a part of this project, look for the printable page in the comment section today, or we can always email it to you. You can request that email at mwithjesus.org. Or we can always even mail you a physical copy of the letter. So let's spread joy this week. If you need perhaps an idea of who you would like to send this to, we have plenty of homebound and friends who would love to hear from you in our church family and continue to pay it forward to spread the joy together. So that's your mission this week. Spread joy. Our first scripture reading this morning is Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is he that made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. Let us pray. Holy Spirit, speak to us through this psalm this morning. As we read your text, may we be attentive to how it may create in us a new heart, a new mind, to think the way you think, to love the way you love, that we would become more like you in our daily lives, in our actions, in our thoughts, in our very being, O God. May your Holy Spirit move in us and create a new way to walk closer to you, letting your word guide our steps, being a light unto our feet and into our path. We pray these things in your awesome name, knowing it's only by your Spirit that you can speak to us this morning. Amen. Our second reading is Matthew chapter 9, beginning with verse 35. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles: first Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus, Simon the Canaan, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions: "Go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news: the kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without payment, give without payment. Take no gold or silver or copper in your belts, no bag for your journey, or two tunics or sandals or a staff, for laborers deserve their food. Whatever town or village you enter, find out who is in it that is worthy, and stay there until you leave. As you enter the house, greet it. If the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. If it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet as you leave that house or town. Truly, I tell you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah on the day of judgment than for that town." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God this morning. There are times in life when we need pause, a reboot, time, moments to remember together, and perhaps in our personal lives, the why behind what we do, the meanings behind our actions. The compassion of Jesus is what leads him in this story to a call to mission to those who follow him. We as believers can so easily lose focus on what that mission is. But Jesus sees the great need and calls the disciples to pray. Ironically, they become the answer to their very prayers. The disciples are sent out, and not just to proclaim the good news, but witness to it in their actions toward the outcast, the sick, and the mistreated. This is risky mission. Responding as Jesus would to the need around us, it might involve risk in various ways, whether financially or physically, politically, or in our lived theology. It is a risk we are called to if we this morning are to remember our mission. What risk are we willing to take to follow the call of Christ? But as we look at our first text from the psalmist this morning, we see that not only do we have this call to Christ in our gospel, this call to mission, but we have a call as well from our psalmist in Psalm 100. We are called to something more. In the midst of this difficult mission, as we seek to live it out not just in word but deed, we must shake off resentments and moments of discouragement and find even joy. with our psalmist today. Our lectionary has connected these two texts, and perhaps in moments such as these, we think that might be an accident. Where can we find joy in this challenging work of mission? Being called to love the oppressed, where can we find joy in such difficult work, perhaps even dangerous work? To say with the psalmist, full of resilience, that yes, even joy is appropriate for us, all of us on the road. This is next level resistance. It is a lifestyle of liberation. So how do we get there? How do we get to joy as we study this text? As we work hard in the movement of compassion, seeking freedom for all people? Joy in hard times as an act of denial is not what we have been called to. Joy that is insincere is not what we have been called to. Joy as in comfortability as others are distressed is not what we have been called to. We have been called to joy as an act of resistance. To you who have been following Jesus to the very streets, living and preaching against injustice, may you find this joy of the psalmist. To those who are looking this very week to become answers to prayers, reaching out to those who are hurting right now, there can be, and perhaps even should be, joy, indescribable. Perhaps somehow part of our very witness, and to the very ones oppressed, despite their pain, they find joy in their daily lives as an act of resistance to a world that wants them to fold or to give up on the fight for justice. Joy is prophetic in that way. This is part of the mission. I was in conversation with my mentor and good friend, Reverend Brandon Perkins, who is an educator and pastor and works with students, about how few moments there really are in our gospel stories of Jesus where Jesus is just laughing, cutting up, having a great time, expressing just an innermost joy. Of course, Scripture attest to the fact that there are so many more stories of Jesus that are not recorded in our gospel text. Perhaps somewhere along the way, those were edited out. Perhaps they weren't seen as essential or the things that folks wanted to make sure were remembered and handed down on the many teachings of Jesus. What a hard job that must have been to make those judgment calls. Or perhaps there are stories that were meant to be passed down, but somewhere along the way, we don't have them. There's a lot of mystery when it comes to the stories that we do have about Jesus, and so many from his life that we don't know. But I'd like to think there were moments of joy. I think about post-resurrection when the disciples are going down the beach, and there they see Jesus with a big fish fry. And he says, "Come on, I've got plenty." And there they are, all having a grill out together. That was moments of joy and companionship and fellowship. But sometimes there's so few pictures of this joy that we can forget how important it is for our lives. The psalmist reminds us that we need joy for the journey in order to be sustainable in mission. The disciples definitely needed joy for this journey we see in the Gospels. Because doing the hard work of compassion, caring for those oppressed, seeking to dismantle systems of injustice, and calling ourselves, especially those who are privileged, to action, this is our call, yes. And we must be obedient to our call. So we will definitely need joy for this journey. Angry reactions to the calls. Joy can diffuse anger. Is there stress and anxiety in our lives as we seek to balance everything during this time when so many around us are hurting and need that phone call and that encouragement that we long to give, but we must care for ourselves too to sustain ourselves for this journey? Joy can meet stress and help melt it away, because joy reminds us that we're not alone, that the Spirit joins us in this work, that the Spirit is at work and active in our lives and those we care to witness to minister to love and to listen to. Even when evil forces seem to be gaining ground, there is a revolution coming. So get busy. Find what the Spirit is calling you to do and pack your joy with the psalmist today, because we need it for the journey. A key to finding this joy and diffusing anger is sometimes simple acts of mission that add up. Our deacon Paul describes mission as 1,000 drops in the ocean that make a great difference eventually, but not always one that we will be able to live to see. I was so proud of our church family in these past weeks. I heard about some of you have been cleaning our streets after a night of clashes between police and protesters and other groups. Perhaps you feel your call is joining an organization that fights racial injustices at this time, or you might protest recent violence targeting especially our friends of color. Or maybe you will challenge yourself to make new relationships in your neighborhood or wherever you are that will help you in this journey and help you find joy. As we look at the gospel message today, how will we interpret Jesus' call to action? Don't forget joy as part of that resistance. Jesus did not call us to comfort. There is a difficult, deep tissue work ahead in institutions such as the church. But we can find joy in our duty. That can keep you in this call for the long game. So many folks who have entered into ministry, after a couple of years, experience what we call burnout. It is so easy when we dedicate ourselves with the right intentions, but we forget to equip ourselves for a sustainable, long-term time in following Christ. I think one of the things perhaps we forget is joy. If there is anything we can learn with standing with the broken, is we have a long journey ahead of us. One march won't do it. One sermon won't do it. We must make a difference every day in Christ's compassion and careful attention to the marginalized. I pray that joy will find you today, and you will stay active in the Lord's work for the long game. Joy is not only this resistance, though. Joy is this very sustainability of mission. You might be asking yourself this week, especially, what can you do to combat hatred and to live into Christ's call to compassion right now? I'll give you 3 keys to get started. Number one, get active in the hard work of self-examination and education. Number two, get busy in the very work of compassion. And three, let yourself be challenged, even uncomfortable, in this time. And remember this, joy as resistance, joy as sustainability, and thirdly, joy is a sign of your sending. Yes, this is part of the call to go out with joy. So go, and go with joy, because you go with God. Amen. This morning, as we read the Nicene Creed, one of the ancient creeds of the church, as part of our affirmation of faith, we want to proudly welcome Dr. Jim Martin into our church family. Today at 11 a.m. after our service, stay on our Facebook Live page and you will see a conversation with Dr. Jim Martin this past week where he shares a little about his faith story. He was officially voted in by our church in the session meeting last week, and when we are all physically together, we will welcome him in a greater way. But we hope you'll take a moment and watch this video that will show at 11 a.m. today, where you can get to know Dr. Jim Martin a little more. He has been visiting our congregation for some time, and we're so glad for him to take this official step in joining us as a family of faith. In that process of discussion and getting to know Dr. Jim Martin, he explained to me that his favorite creed out of all the confessions that we have in our rich treasury in the Presbyterian Church of confessions and creeds is the Nicene Creed. And especially because of the communal wording in the Nicene Creed, where you see a lot of we instead of I. That is one of his favorite pictures of the church, that we're in this together, and that uniquely we share in this faith story, so that if perhaps you're not feeling up to reading the creed today, there's a brother or a sister who will read it on your behalf because we're in this family of faith together. It's a we that when we join the church together. So, with that being said, Christian, what do you believe? Let us read the Nicene Creed. It can be found on page 15 in your blue Presbyterian hymnal if you have a copy with you at home. Or, as always, it's available on our virtual bulletin below in the comments section. Let us read together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We come at this time as a family of faith to pray together. We want to especially remember our beloved elder and longtime church member, Mary Sullivan, who will be in surgery this very week. Please keep her in your prayers. We want to remember all those who are homebound and hurting, all those who are affected by COVID-19, all those affected by institutional racism and all forms of hatred. Let us pray for our safety and health committee as we look to prepare a welcoming experience back to our building on July the 12th. Perhaps you have a prayer request that was not mentioned. Please take a moment and put it in our comments section. We would love to pray for you this week. Let us go to the Lord in prayer together. Compassionate God, lead us closer to you as we seek to love those you love. Help us become truly more like you in our acts of mercy and justice and compassion. Help us become answers to prayers as part of this call, and in that call, help us find joy. and not only find it in our own personal lives, but spread joy with a note of encouragement this week, or an act of duty or an act of mission. Fill our hearts with your joy and thanksgiving for your mercy so that we will gladly share it with others. We remember at this time our homebound, the loneliness that they might be experiencing. We ask that you be with them in a very special way, even this very moment, Lord Jesus. And all those that have been affected by COVID-19, Lord, in your mercy, be with those who mourn. Help us mourn with those that mourn. Help us rejoice with those that rejoice as we find your joy together in your call to mission. We pray for our leaders who must be under incredible stress at this time, medical, scientific, our nation's leaders of all kinds, pastors and ministers and nurses and doctors, all those around the world that are experiencing extra stress and anxiety as they try to lead us in the right way. God, we ask for your wisdom. We ask for your patience, that as we begin to reopen, that we will do so safely, that we will be considerate of others, that we will look for ways that we can be encouraging to one another and build each other up, whether it be supporting small businesses or getting to know our neighbor's name. There's so many opportunities to share your light and your love. Lord, we bring before you the sins of white dominance in ways, God, that racism still prevails in our institutions, even the church. Not only do we repent of these things, but we ask that we would be active in combating hatred with your love, that we would truly seek to be anti-racist in all our decisions and policies and words and deeds, and that we would live into the coming of your kingdom. God, help us be more like you. And now, coming together, we lift up the prayer requests right now that are in the comment section, those spoken and those unspoken, praying the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, wherever you are, we hope you'll take an opportunity to give. It's in the way that we give that we acknowledge that all belongs to God. And at this important and unique time and trying time in our ministry, we ask that you give generously and from your heart. Multiple ways that you can give. As always, you can mail us a check at 875 Elmwood Avenue, zip code 14222. Or you can go online at elmwoodjesus.org, and there's a way to give there on our website. Or right now, if you're watching on Facebook Live, in our comment section, we have a link where you can give. May we all worship the Lord together as we give. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, it's with deep thanksgiving that we give and receive. And we ask that these funds, these tithes and offerings, as acts and dedication and sacrifice, recognizing you and all we do, would be used for you. Give us wisdom in how we distribute, how we give, that it would all be used for the building up of your reign, your light and your love in this community and far beyond. And we ask all these things in your awesome name. Amen. And so, don't forget to pack your joy this week. As we celebrate freedom, when we think of Juneteenth this week, I hope you will celebrate with acts of joy and liberation for all people. And now, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen.